all right?
Yes,
thank you. Excellent. It is lovely to see you
this lovely sunny morning
out on the farm. Through away, thank you to Christine and James for hosting us, and to everybody who put any work into this morning, because a lot of work goes into getting our lovely barn ready. I was just saying to James, it's a lovely morning, and we always get a lovely morning, but then he reminded me that last year wasn't just so lovely. So it's rose tinted glasses. We always have a lovely morning when we come out to harvest. And just a couple of announcements before we start. Book club is meeting on Tuesday at 2:30, so hopefully you are well read up. A reminder that next Sunday evening, High Street Presbyterian are having their 200th anniversary, celebrating 200 years on the High Street, and that's at 7 o'clock in High Street Presbyterian. It's always lovely when we can celebrate together. And a little birdie told me that the couple here will be celebrating their 60th wedding anniversary tomorrow. So a big congratulations to Ken and Eleanor. I'm not sure which one it is that deserves the medal, but congratulations anyway. So we come to worship this morning. And the call to worship is on the inside of your order of service. But we take a moment of silence to still our hearts before the Lord as we come to worship. How good it is to give thanks to God. How good it is good to give thanks for God's steadfast love and faithfulness.
Let us then give thanks to God. Let us worship God with thanksgiving.
And the words to the hymns are on your order of service. We're going to join in singing our first hymn, Come, Ye Thankful People, Come.
Thank you.
Father God, we come before you this harvest Thanksgiving Sunday. We want to thank you for the beauty of your earth, for the beauty of the countryside around us this morning, for the cows in the fields, for the green grass, for the birds that we can hear tweeting around us. Father, we thank you for the privilege that it is to be in your nature. We give thanks for those who supply all that we eat. There is more on that chain than we even realize, from the farmer who grows the food to the person who rings it through at the till. We give thanks for all in that chain. Father, we come thankful that we are your children, that we bow before you as those who you love, as those who you provide for, Jehovah Jireh, the great provider. And Father, we come knowing that we are anything but perfect. And so we bow our heads before you in confession, knowing that Christ took our sin upon himself on the cross. And Father, that we have that blessed assurance of your forgiveness, of your grace and your mercy. So, Father, as we meet as church in this place this morning, would your presence surround us? Would your spirit be with us? And would you be glorified in our worship? And we ask this in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. We have two readings this morning. The first will be taken from the book of Joel, and we'll be reading from chapter 2, verses 21 to 27. And then we will be going to the New Testament, reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 25 to 35. So first, a reading from Joel. Do not be afraid, land of Judah. Be glad and rejoice. Surely the Lord has done great things. Do not be afraid, you wild animals, for the pastures in the wilderness are becoming green. The trees are bearing their fruit. The fig tree and the vine yield their riches. Be glad, people of Zion. Rejoice in the Lord your God, for he has given you the autumn rain. Because he is faithful. He sends you abundant showers, with autumn and spring rains as before. The threshing floors will be filled with grain. The vats will overflow with new wine and oil. I will repay you for the years the locusts have eaten. The great locust and the young locust, the other locusts and the locust swarm. My great army that I sent among you. You will have plenty to eat until you are full, and you will praise the name of the Lord your God, who has worked wonders for you. Never again will my people be shamed. Then you will know that I am in Israel, and that I am the Lord your God, and that there is no other. Never again will my people be shamed. Then reading from the book of Matthew. Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you? You of little faith. So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. And we give thanks for these readings from God's word and ask that his blessing would be upon them. We're going to sing our second hymn now, All Creatures of Our God and King.
Thank you.
Now, I have a bit of a challenge this morning. And don't worry, it doesn't involve dressing up this week. So I need two people to come and help me. Two people who enjoy bread. Now, remember last week I picked on someone. So if you don't volunteer, I will be picking on two people to come and help me. Excellent. Catherine. You just want to stand at the front of my hay pulpit. I will come and join you in a moment. Are you just going to come and join Catherine? Don't leave her on her own. Should we make it a family thing? Andrew, do you want to come and challenge your cousin? Come on. Right, Andrew's going to do it. Okay, so I have four different types of bread. Okay, so I'm going to trust you to close, or maybe both of you can take your glasses off and that would work. I'm going to trust you to close your eyes and not look at the bread before I give it to you, and then you have to tell me what kind of bread you think it is. So right, come across and stand facing that way so that you're...
Thank you.
not so easy to recognise these things when you have your eyes closed and it's not really the context that you're expecting it, but well done to my two volunteers. But isn't it amazing that the flour needed to make all of this different kind of bread comes from a simple seed? A tiny little seed that the farmer plants. He cares for it. We often watch them out the back of our house, spraying it and keeping an eye on it. The rain waters it, the sun nurtures it, all sent by God. And then it grows to become a crop like this. A crop that can be harvested and refined, turned into flour, and then skilled bakers use it to make all of these different varieties of bread that end up in our supermarkets, just like the ones that we're trying this morning. From these small seeds comes the food that our bodies need to live, to give us energy to do everything that we do. But we don't just have bread to eat, do we? God has provided us with many other delicious foods to enjoy, some of which we will be having later on. Today we're celebrating harvest. And harvest is a time for us to remember that all of our food is provided by the Lord. He is the one who gives us the seeds, the soil, the rain, and the sun. He is the one who gives strength to those who work on the land to plant the seeds and harvest the crops. He is the one who fills the ocean with fish and the land with animals that we can enjoy to eat. Listen to this verse from the Message Bible, from Acts 14, verse 17. But even then, he didn't leave them without a clue. For he made a good creation, poured down rain and gave bumper crops. When your bellies were full and your hearts happy, there was evidence of good beyond your doing. God has always provided for his people, and that is what we are thankful for this morning. The passage we read from Matthew reminds us that we don't need to worry about anything. Instead of worrying, we should place our faith and trust in God, and he provides for us because he values us. Jesus assures us that he is in control when he says, "That is why I tell you not to worry about everyday life, whether you have enough food and drink or enough clothes to wear. Isn't life more than food and your body more than clothing?" He doesn't just tell us not to worry, but gives a good reason why we shouldn't worry. "That is why I tell you" refers back to the previous verse in which Jesus declares that a Christian's only master is God. He is therefore saying, because God is your master, I tell you not to worry. God is not only the master of you, but he is the master of the universe, and everything is in his control. In the Greek, the command, "do not worry," includes the idea of stopping what is already being done. In other words, we are to stop worrying and never start it again. Furthermore, it's not just the big issues of life that we shouldn't worry about, but every aspect of our lives should be free from worry. And that means all of a person's being, physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual. Jesus is referring to life in its fullest possible sense. Absolutely nothing in any aspect of our lives, internal or external, justifies our worrying when we have the master that we do. Worry can be seen as a sin, and the English term worry comes from an old German word meaning to strangle or choke. And that is exactly what worry does. It is a kind of mental and emotional strangulation which probably causes more mental and physical afflictions than any other single cause. The needs that Jesus mentions here are the most basic. What we eat, what we drink, what we put on. Throughout Bible times, food and water could seldom be taken for granted. When there was little snow in the mountains, there was little water in the rivers, and inadequate rainfall was frequent. Shortage of water naturally brought shortage of food, which seriously affected the whole economy and made clothes harder to buy. Yet Jesus said, "Do not worry about any of these things." Jesus is saying that there are more important things in life than these seemingly indispensable things, and the thing that is most important to him is you. It's amazing that we value things, but God values people. Jesus illustrates his point by saying, "Look at the birds. They don't plant or harvest or store food in barns, for your heavenly Father feeds them. And aren't you far more valuable to him than they are? There are many birds in northern Galilee, and it's likely that Jesus pointed to some passing birds as he said, look at the birds. As an object lesson, he called attention to the fact that birds do not have intricate and involved processes for getting their food. Like every creature, birds have their life from God. But God does not say to them, in effect, I've done my part, from now on you're on your own. The Lord has provided them with an abundance of food resources and the instinct to find those resources for themselves and their offspring. If God so carefully takes care of such relatively insignificant creatures as birds, how much more will he take care of those who are created in his own image and who have become his children through faith? The very fact that God sent his Son to die on the cross in the sinner's place should give you some idea of the value he places upon human beings who were created in his image and likeness. Jesus not only tells us not to worry, but asks us, what's the point? He says, can all your worries add a single moment to your life? Worry makes no sense, for it changes nothing. It's a waste of energy and does not help in any way that matters. Havner stated, worry, like a rocking chair, will give you something to do, but it won't get you anywhere. We need to stop worrying because we are God's prized treasure. He will never abandon us. He will never forsake us. He will never forget about us. He will always be there for us because we serve an awesome God. The same goes for what we wear. Jesus continues his point by using another plentiful visual illustration. Look at the lilies of the field and how they grow. They don't work or make their clothing. Yet Solomon, in all his glory, was not dressed as beautifully as they are. This expression draws to mind God's provision in nature for flowers growing wild, which probably surrounded Jesus, the disciples, and the crowd as he spoke. So what is Jesus' point? Simple. He cares about us. He says, and if God cares so wonderfully for wild flowers that are here today and thrown into the fire tomorrow, he will certainly care for you. Here, Jesus' point is not about survival, but splendor, because the flowers are here today and gone tomorrow. Yet God gives them such beauty that even the richest of the rich cannot match. If God gives so much care to a part of his creation that soon disappears, how much more does God give to the pinnacle of his creation, humans? Jesus is saying that God, who created such a magnificent universe, is certainly capable of meeting our essential needs. Christian guitarist Phil Keaggy, in his song A Time and a Place, said these words. Said the robin to the sparrow, "I would really like to know why these anxious human beings rush about and worry so." Said the sparrow to the robin, "Friend, I think that it must be that they have no heavenly father, such as cares for you and me." The Bible tells us that he cares about us so much that he even has the hairs on our head numbered. He cares about us so much that he promises to meet all our needs. He cares about us so much that he sent his only son to earth to die for us. We shouldn't worry because of God's promises. He promised never to leave us or forsake us. He promised to provide for us. He promised to protect us. And he promised to prepare a place for us. God knows all our needs. And so Jesus says, so don't worry about these things, saying, what will we eat? What will we drink? What will we wear? These things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers, but your heavenly Father already knows all your needs. Those who have no hope in God naturally put their hope and expectations in material things that they can enjoy now. They have nothing to live for but the present, and anything they get, they must get for themselves. They are ignorant of God's supply. However, we are not like that, for we have a heavenly Father who cares for us. It's time to stop letting worry steal from you. It will steal your rest. It will steal your health, and it will steal your peace. It's time to stop letting worry control you. If you let worry, it will control every aspect of your life. It's time to start letting God control every aspect of your life. It's time to start letting God have control of your present. And it's time to start letting God have control of your future. And so we remember the God that gives us all the many kinds of bread from these little kernels. Is the God who provides for you, who provides for all of us. Jesus is a Messiah who provides. He provides because he values you above all. He provides because he cares for you above all else. And he provides because he has a plan for your life. And today, we give thanks for that provision. Amen. And we're going to join in singing our next hymn, We Plough the Fields and Scatter. Generous God, we pray today for all who work to bring us food, and for all who speak out for those who have little food. We pray for those who will not have enough to eat today, and for all those who are working to bring help. In every place, bring your hope and healing. Lord, in your mercy. healing God. We pray today for all who endure pain, in mind or body, and for those who help. We pray for those working in hospitals and those in research, those who work in our community, and those caring out of love. In every place, bring your hope and healing. Lord, in your prayer. Joyful God, we pray today for all who bring us the light and help us show praise and thanks in our daily lives. For our children and those we love, for those who entertain and those who create beauty in words and music, paint or clay, we pray that your creative life would overflow with joy. In every place, bring your hope and healing. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Holy God, we pray today for the life of our church, for all who serve and all who lead. Help us to be people who share generously and speak boldly of your love. Give our leaders and teachers wisdom, and give each of us the courage we need to follow you. In every place, bring your hope and healing. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, we pray for ourselves, knowing that you see each of us with eyes of love. Help us to love ourselves as you love us, and to reflect your image into the world around us. In our lives, bring hope and healing. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. And we join together in singing our final hymn, Creation Sings the Father's Song. Thank you. hopefully it's warm and sunny enough for us to be able to sit outside. There are lots of tables and chairs which will need moved. But if you do wish to stay inside the barn here, we can do that as well. And I'm sure there will be people telling you where to go to get your food and your tea and coffee and stuff. So let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this time together, for this fellowship that we are going to enjoy together over food. We thank you for those who have cooked and prepared it for us. And Father, would you just be amongst us in this time together. And now may the blessing of the God who cycles the seasons and swells the grain go with us. May the blessing of the sun who harvests and kneads and breaks the bread go with us. May the blessing of the Spirit who challenges us to a just sharing of earth's harvest go with us now and into the week ahead. Amen.